shackle by sin.
It's already gone. I'm happy reminding him he's under the blood.
No shackle by
sin. It's already gone. I'm happy reminding him he's under the blood.
Amen. Take your hymnal now tonight. Turn to page 289. Come unto me. Let's all stand, sing the first, second, and last. 289. Come unto me. Amen. Please remain standing as our pastor comes. Brother Ron Thomas, would you lead us in prayer tonight?
Thanking you,
yes, Lord,
for the blood, Lord,
right,
the blood of the precious Savior shed on that rugged cross.
Yes, thank you, Lord Jesus.
Rough sinner like me, Father, yes. I praise you that one day, as the song says, I came unto you, and Lord, you have given me rest and peace
right,
in my life. looking forward. We're watching for you to come any day, Lord. I pray that you'll bless in the remainder of the service, the choir, singing, and the preacher as he comes and breaks the word of life. Thank you, Father, for the wonderful Holy Spirit-filled service that we have this morning.
Yes,
Lord, for everything that's said and done, we'll give you the praise, the honor, and the glory.
Right.
Name is above every name, the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Shake hands with someone if you can. You can reach somebody if you can't. Smile at them. Good to see you in the house of God tonight on this weather, this windy night in the house of God. Boy, it's calm and comfortable in here, isn't it? We're glad to see you tonight. If you're visiting with us for the first time, make yourself at home. It's good to have Jack and Vicki Kleinard. These are missionaries that are sending helps to the Ukraine, King James Bibles in particular. And they're here tonight, and we're glad to have them in our midst tonight. Let me remind you of now to pray for the Ellison family and the Watson family. Brother Greg Ellison went home to be with the Lord, and that is, of course, Sister Watson's brother. Brother, so pray for that family tonight. And then we're going to be going to the Jubilee, Winter Jubilee, down at Williamston soon. The choir. Choir will be singing on the 21st. And of course, that's Brother, where Brother Lyle is right now, leading singing for Brother Robbie Robinson. And that's the Trinity Baptist Church in Williamston. So be remembering that. The choir will be singing on that 21st. The ladies' prayer circle is this coming Tuesday night. Bring a cover dish. And Gina Jordan will be speaking to the ladies on that night. And then the Master Club, Wednesday night, our midweek service. And Master Club meets on Wednesday night also. Sunday school next Sunday. Next Sunday at 10 o'clock. We invite everybody to be in any of all these services. All right, ushers, you come and you pray for the service tonight. I had a great service this morning. Kind of rested my voice a little. But I'm still having trouble with it. Just pray that God will work it out in his own good time. There's got to be a reason for it. I mean, you know, God will get glory out of any and everything comes our way. So we're trusting him and that he'll just lead, guide, and direct in everything that's going on here. And Sister Gail Henson, I have some information for you after service tonight. Brother Rick, lead us in a word of prayer.
Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you once again for the honor and privilege to be back in your house tonight, Lord. Lord, we thank you for the good Lord's Day you gave us, Lord. We thank you for the service this morning, Lord. For the sweet Holy Spirit to visit with us, Lord. We pray, Lord, for that Spirit each and every time we're here, Lord. We thank you for that privilege, Lord Jesus. Thank you for the choir and Sammy and the musicians, Lord. Bless them tonight, Lord, as they sing for your glory. Lord, be with those that couldn't be here tonight, Lord. For those that are sick, Lord, I pray that you'd touch them in a mighty way, Lord. Heal them, Lord, according to thy will, Lord Jesus. Be with our pastor, Lord. I pray that you'd lay your hands upon him, Lord. Strengthen him, Lord. Heal his voice, Lord. Lift him up. Help him to be strong, Lord, and to guide us, Lord, the way he needs to, Lord. We thank you for him, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for this offering. For it's in Jesus' name we ask. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, choir, for the good singing tonight. And I'm going to start my message tonight, but I don't know where I'll finish it or not. We'll go as far as the Lord will let us go. But I want you to turn to Matthew chapter number 27. This is on page 1042. 1042 in the old Scofield Bible, Matthew chapter number 27, verse number 51. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent, and the graves were opened. And many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of their graves after his resurrection, and went into the holy city and appeared unto many. Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and the things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, truly this was the Son of God. Brother, in our Sunday school lesson, we've even studied where demons recognize the Son of God. People know that Jesus is the Son of God, whether they accept him as Savior or not. They know he's different than any other personality that ever graced this earth. Nobody has ever done what Jesus Christ did on this earth. Brother, you and I are shouting tonight, shouted this morning, sang his praises, blessed his name, hallelujah, shed tears of joy because of what he did at Calvary. And you and I tonight have that right. You and I have every right in the world to praise the Lord without shame. We don't have to be intimidated by anybody out there in the world. Nobody can tell us what to do with our Savior. Nobody has any authority over us tonight. The only one that has authority over us is the Savior himself. And bless God, I'm so glad to submit to him. I'm so glad that I have, by the grace of God, humbled myself before the mighty hand of God that he might lift me up in due time, and he has. Now, from Christ's death on the cross of Calvary to his great and marvelous resurrection, many great things happened. We couldn't name them all, but we know that the earthquake, the rocks rent, and the graves opened, and saints of God arose from the dead after his resurrection. The sun darkened. And then the thing that I want us to notice in particular tonight, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. And my friend, this is a great story. Many of us know about it. But we need to be reminded. We need to be reminded tonight of just how great that situation was and what it accomplished for you and me. Now, between the holy place and the holy of holies, there was a great veil that separated the two compartments, the holy of holies and the holy place and the holy of holies. Now, behind that veil was the ark and, of course, the cherubim and the mercy seat, and where God came down and dwelt with the children of Israel. That's where God met with them, and there had to have a high priest that would come in on the Day of Atonement with blood, the blood for himself and the blood for others, and offer that blood to God, before God and before that altar, recognizing that one day, that one glorious day, a lamb would come. Now, there were many millions of lambs slain, many picturing the day when the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world would appear. Well, right here, he appeared. He went to Calvary. He bled and died. And when he died on the cross of Calvary, that big, great veil between the holy and the holy of holies was torn in half from the top to the bottom. Not from the bottom up, but from the top down. And they tell us, and I've read where they said that you could put two teams of horses on either side of that veil, hooked to that veil, and those horses could not split that veil, could not tear that veil. But when Jesus died, that was the greatest event, that's the greatest victory that's ever been won for mankind, and God was pleased with what Jesus did on the cross, and he split that veil just like it was a piece of thread. It was not a shear. It was a thick piece of a material, and it was split right down the middle. Brother, I want to tell you something. We serve an awesome God tonight. We're serving an awesome God, and people are trying to make us doubt whether our God's going to come through for us. Let me tell you something. Looking bad all over the world. And we know that sin is running rampant in the land. But look, praise God, keep on shouting. Because listen, the very moment that you back off and you get discouraged and you let the devil whip you down, then that's when he's going to come. You're going to look like a fool. Keep on shouting. Yeah, the devil said, where's your God tonight, preacher? If your God's so great, why doesn't he open up your voice? That's his business. That's his business. Maybe if I had my full voice, I may try to show off a little, and I wouldn't bring glory to God. But if God does anything for anybody tonight, it'll be God all the way. It won't be Sammy Kay at all. Rather, it'll be him. I don't know why we go through these things, but that's okay. Man, I accept it. I accept it. I still say hallelujah. I still say praise the Lord. I'll tell you, if he takes it all the way away, I'm going to whisper glory to God. Hallelujah. What a Savior that can take a poor lost sinner like I am, that's hell-bent and hell-bound and needs to go to hell, and he can take that sinner like y'all sung about tonight. Y'all have sung graciously again tonight. And brother, we're talking about a Savior now that's alive and well. And he's seated at the right hand of the authority of God in heaven for you and for me. I hope I can get a little further in this message tonight. But millions and millions of animals were sacrificed, blood shed, but all typifying the coming Lamb of God. So in Hebrews 9:24, if you want to get blessed, turn to the book of Hebrews anytime and start reading, and you'll get up praising God. Listen to this. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 24, for Christ is not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the true, but into heaven itself. Into heaven itself. That's where Jesus is. That's where he entered. What for? Not, and now to appear in the presence of God for us. So how in the world are you going to lose out when you've got a Savior that died for you on the cross, that suffered like nobody's ever suffered, loved you that much, and greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. He laid his life down. If he would do that, suffer like that, and then go to heaven and intercede for us, what do you got to worry about? What are you worried about? Why can't you sleep at night? Why? Now, I mean, you may not be able to sleep if you got colic or something like that, but praise God, you don't have colic all the time. You have a restful night, but that peace that passeth all understanding is there for you. Listen, nor yet that he should offer himself often as the high priest entereth into the holy place every year with blood of others. For then must he have suffered since the foundation of the world. If Jesus had to repeat it over and over and over again, ever so often, he would be dying from the foundation of the world. But that's not the way it happened, friend. All of those animal sacrifices were just pictures. They could not take away one sin. And so the Bible says, but now, once, one time, in the end of the world, hath he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Not an animal, but himself. That's the greatest sacrifice that has ever been given, the blood of Jesus Christ. Do you not feel close to him tonight? Do you not feel the Holy Ghost of God in your very being tonight? Thinking about what Jesus did for you and for me, look at this verse in 28 now, Hebrews 9:28. So Christ was once offered, once, to bear the sins of many, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. I'm looking for him. I'm looking for him tonight with anticipation. He may not come tonight. I'm going to be looking for him in the morning. I'm going to look for him till he comes. You listen to this preacher tonight. I'm not much. I know that. I consider myself at the bottom when it comes to preachers and all of that. But let me tell you something. I got a Savior that I adore with all my heart, with all my mind, with all my soul, with all my strength. I'm telling you, I'm looking for my Savior to come. One day he's gonna come and show me that I didn't believe in vain. I'm not believing in vain. I believe the truth, and the truth made me free. I was in bondage. I was in darkness. I had no hope at all till Jesus came to me. And so, my friend, what does all of this really mean? Let me hasten on and say a few words. It was the end of the ceremonial law. When that veil was rent, that was the end of ceremonial law. Hallelujah. It was the end of sacrificing of animals. Not another animal had to die. No, not another one. That was over. And my friend, there was no more need for an earthly priest. Hey, I didn't need an earthly priest to represent me. I've got the eternal high priest. And brother, I don't have to have a priest to go behind the veil once a year on my behalf. I got one that's eternal every day that I live, every breath that I take. That Savior is there. That priest, that high priest is there. Now, Jesus is our one and only high priest. He's not our representative for a day or a certain day. He's our representative for time and for eternity. Now, the literal time right here, the Day of Atonement, is over to, in other words, we have been reconciled. We've been reconciled to God. You and I, we're one with God now. Whew. Hallelujah. I wish I could preach to you right now. This is getting gooder and gooder. The further I go, better and better. Now, the supreme lamb was sacrificed. He came. Jesus is our mercy seat now. Jesus is our altar. Jesus is our sacrifice. Jesus is our high priest. Jesus is our eternal Savior. He is our everything. He's the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by him. Now, the way to the holy God of heaven, the way to the Father, is through the Son. In Hebrews chapter 9 and verse number 12, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood. Brother, think about it. By his own blood, he entered in. Once, there's you once again, he entered in once, not 100 times, not 1,000 times, but one time. One time was enough. It took care of it. Entered in once into the holy place. The holy place. Having obtained what? Eternal redemption for us. So you and I are sitting here tonight saved by the grace of God. You and I are sitting here right now with eternal forgiveness. Our sins will never come up again. All of our sins are under the blood. Whenever the devil tells you you deserve a place with him in hell, you can shout in his face and say, thank God, I may deserve it, but I ain't going because I've got the blood applied to my heart. And my friend, I'm trusting Jesus. Then in verse number 10 of chapter 10, he said, by the which will we are sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Look at the once, the one time. No more need for a cross. There'll never be another Calvary. There'll never be another Savior coming and being whipped and spat upon and treated cruelly. No, that'll never happen again. Jesus will never have another cat of nine tails put on his back. He'll never go through any more suffering. He did it all when he came the first time. So then verse number 12 says, but this man, after he had offered how many? One. He had offered one sacrifice for sins for how long? Forever. You and I are saved forever and forever and forever. And you say, but Brother Sammy, I don't feel like I'm that saved. I don't either. I certainly don't feel like I'm saved right now, but I know I am, because it's what he said and not what I feel. It's not what this old body feels badly sometimes. And a lot of times, especially when you go to aging, you get weak, and sometimes you forget something. I mean, you just forget. You can't think. Trying to think of some name of somebody I know very well. Can't think of them. Now, verse number 14, he said, for by one offering he hath perfected for how long? Forever. Forever. Now, I'm reading it out of the Bible. I'm not making it up. This is not some little freely sermon that we dreamed up, brother. I'm reading it right out of the King James Bible. And it says, forever them that are sanctified, perfected forever. That's the way you are. That's the way I am. In Jesus tonight, we are perfected forever. Nothing, nothing, nothing can ever come in the way that would rob us of this perfection. Because it's not our perfection in the flesh. It's his that we're claiming. When I stand before Jesus one day, I'll never say, Lord, wasn't I a great servant? Didn't I serve you? Boy, I made it in, didn't I, Lord? No, I'm going to stand there with all the humility of my soul, and I'm going to say, thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want to thank you for dying for Sammy Kay. I was on my way to hell. I was lost and undone. I didn't have a chance, and I didn't know why I was in your world. But praise God, you came to me. You came where I was. Hallelujah. Sinners can now approach God. We who are dirty sinners can now approach a holy God. How? Because we finally got better? No. Because we have one that goes between. One that washed our sins away and gave us his righteousness for our sin. He who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And then in verse number 19, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Now, I can enter into that holy. I can enter into that holy place. I can enter into the holy of holies by the blood of the Lord Jesus. Where God dwells, I can go right into where God dwells. And brother, talk to God. In our time, we've come in and fall on our knees and with joy in our heart, we talk to God. Talk to God. There was a day in my life I couldn't do that. There was a day in my life I didn't even know how. There was a day in my life I didn't know I could. But now I know I can. I come in here on every morning. I average about 5 o'clock. That's my average. Sometimes something happens, I can't make it or have to go somewhere. But as a regular thing, I try to get in here by 5 o'clock. Well, look, I'm glad I'm coming here every morning and talk to God. Not because I'm good. Not because I'm better than somebody, but because I believe. I believe. And I come to him. My, my, my. My, my, my. What a Savior. And then in verse number 23, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. For he is faithful that promised. Glory to God. Say, it's not your and my faithfulness that's going to get us through. It's his. His faithfulness. I don't care what kind of problem you have tonight or tomorrow or next week or before you get to heaven, but no matter what you have, he's going to be right there with you. And he's not going to walk out on you. He's going to help you through every trial, every test. And you say, well, Brother Sammy, why do we have to suffer? Sin's to blame. Now, that doesn't mean that you're actually sinning right now, but it means sin that came into the world when Adam sinned brought death, brought sickness, brought pain, brought murder, brought killings, brought all the hell that's going on in our world. Blame sin. Don't blame God. God's saying, come unto me all ye that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Man says, God, you bug off. You bug off. That's what we're studying in Sunday school right now. That bunch of scribes, Pharisees, Herodians, joined together and try to destroy Jesus. And they said that he has Beelzebub. That's the devil. And so they committed the unpardonable sin. We taught it in Sunday school this morning. They said that Jesus was in league with the devil. That's why he was doing so many miracles. So he was in league with the power of the devil. And the Bible says they blasphemed, not just blasphemed the Holy Spirit, but blasphemed against the Holy Spirit. And the Bible says, from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And so after they got in their heart, they hated God and didn't want God, the Holy Ghost, and wanted to attribute the work of Jesus in that day to the dumb god of the devil. They said, we don't want the Holy Ghost. They knew that what Jesus was doing was of God, but they didn't want God. They didn't want any of that. So their heart, first of all, rejected. That's the blasphemy of the Holy Ghost. Rejection first, words later. Now, God can forgive for saying words. People have cursed God and been forgiven for it. But whenever you set yourself against the Holy Ghost and say, oh, he's of the devil, or that work of Jesus is of the devil, the devil's in cahoots with him. They're together. Brother, you're going to hell, and you are not going to be forgiven when you set yourself against the Holy. And now I'm not talking about the words now. The words are bad, but the rejection is worse. The heart, when your heart turns against the Holy Ghost, you're done for. And brother, you better know that. But there's not anybody in this house of God tonight has ever committed an unpardonable sin, because you are here tonight. If you had committed the unpardonable sin, you'd be hating the Holy Ghost. You'd be hating singing. You'd be hating the Bible. You'd be hating everything that God is and stands for. And you'd be doing just like those scribes and Pharisees and Herodians and all the rest of them. You'd be blaspheming the Holy Ghost. But see, you're not doing that tonight. I don't care how mean you are. I don't care how mean you are. Right yonder by television. I don't care how mean you are. Listen, God died for you. Jesus died for you. And if you'll accept that and accept it in your heart, you'll be forgiven of every sin. Now in 2 Peter 3:5, and let me tell you this, that was a literal veil, but there's also a spiritual veil that hides men from God. And it's made up, first of all, of ignorance. Over in Romans 10:3. For they being ignorant of God's righteousness, and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. That believeth. 2 Peter 3:5. For this they are willingly ignorant. Willingly. A lot of people are ignorant. We'll talk about that later. But a lot of folk are willingly ignorant. They don't care. If they ever learn about God, they don't want to learn about God. And so they're willingly ignorant. And such ignorance veils sinners from God. If you're ignorant and you're willingly to be ignorant, you can't see what we're seeing tonight. And then there's that unbelief. Unbelief, Romans 11:20. Because of unbelief, they were broken off. That would take you down when you won't believe the word of God. Natural Israel tonight is judicially blinded. Israel doesn't know Jesus as Messiah as a nation tonight. That's the reason they're in trouble in right now. They rejected him when he came the first time. And they're going to be in trouble until the end of the tribulation period. And there, God's going to open their eyes. They're going to see Jesus as the true Messiah, and there's going to be a remnant spared at the end of the tribulation to go into the kingdom. Go into the kingdom. I'm awaiting that day. I'm looking forward to that day. And so unbelief veils sinners from God. Disobedience, Romans 10:21. All day long, God said, I've stretched out my hand to a gainsaying people, those that contradict God, that argue about God. He said, I've stretched out my hand to show you how real I am, but you would not. And then darkness, John 12:35. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness come upon you, and you be walking in darkness, and you'll know not whether you're going. Know not where you're going. People that are in darkness tonight, they don't know Jesus, They don't know where they're going. They're just going every which way. That's why you've got perversion on the increase. They're coming up with a new kind of perversion every few days, doing something stupid, something evil. Brother, it's getting worse. And they want all of us to accept all of that and say, okay, it's okay. Now, I may not try to hurt anybody that differs with me. I may not even run a pervert out of this church. If a pervert wants to come in this church and sit down, behave, and listen to the Word of God, he's welcome. But now if he tries to cram his religion or his belief, whatever it might be, down my throat, he stops right here. I'm not accepting all this perversion that's going on in the world. So they're in darkness, the Bible says. So you got that. You got all these things that really do veil the sinner from God. And then pride. Pride in Ephesians 2:8-9. For by grace are you saved, and that not of yourself. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Boast about, oh, I'm good. I do good. I haven't sinned in 3 years. I've had people tell me all these stories. I don't sin. And one man said, what do I ask forgiveness for? I don't do anything wrong. If I do anything wrong, it's to myself. I don't do it to anybody else. Just talk. Let me tell you something, friend. You better wake up, because all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So these things veil God's presence and God's power from us. Now, when we turn to Jesus, that veil is gone. Every bit of that's gone. All your disobedience, all your ignorance, all your pride, every bit of that's broken away. And now you see. Now you see. And you humble yourself before the mighty hand of God. What happened? And I close with this. A new birth. Jesus said you must be born again. A new life. The Bible says, I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. And a new way. I am the way. Hey, not the way you were going, not the way you were living, but I am the way. Come to me. Him that cometh to me, I'll in no wise cast out. And then a new experience. What an experience we had. The day you got saved, the night you got saved, how that you left all your troubles behind and gave them to him. Gave them to him. Boy, I tell you, slept the best that night you've ever slept in your lifetime when you knew that your sins were gone. In 1 Thessalonians 5:23, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray, God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is coming. All right? All you have to do is trust him. The veil is gone. The veil is gone. We don't have to offer any sacrifices. I don't have an earthly priest, an earthly man. I don't confess my sins to any man. If you've got a sin in your life, you don't have to confess to any man. You confess it to him. And if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So, brother, we've got a God tonight. And we've sung about him, and we've tried to preach about him, and we love him tonight, do we not? Let's all stand. And by the way, if there's anybody here tonight or by streaming, you're not saved, you'd like to be saved, the altar's open here, and we're here. And we'll be here as long as we have to show you how to be saved. If you want to come forward after the benediction or during the benediction, whenever, you're always welcome to come. Our Father in heaven, thank you for this good day. Thank you for getting us through another day of praising God, worshiping the Lord. We thank you for our Savior. Oh, hallelujah, what a Savior who can take a poor, dirty, scroungy, hell-bound sinner and lift him up from that miry clay, set his feet upon a solid rock, the solid rock, and establish his goings. Thank God, put singing in our heart, put a song of praise on our lips. And Lord, we love you tonight. Thank you for every blessing. Bless this church. Help all of us that are sick and we're having the problems. Just undertake when you get ready. We're just waiting on you.